If everyone would please come in at your convenience. My name is Wayne Wolfson. I'm the president of NCMIC and a proud FCA member for the past 37 years. Before introducing our speaker, just a few short comments. Many of you were no doubt looking forward to seeing Dr. Louis Sportelli here in Orlando. Unfortunately, he's been dealing with a family illness and is unable to join us. He sends his regrets, missing his first FCA national meeting in 35 years, but rest assured, he'll be on stage this time next year. In the interim, on behalf of Lou, our entire board, including Vince Lucido, past FCA and ACA president, and Pat McNerney, our CEO, who are both here today, thanks for joining us. I would be remiss if I didn't take this opportunity to make a few short comments regarding the breadth of NCMIC's offerings. As many of you know, NCMIC is the leader in chiropractic malpractice insurance. Founded by and for doctors of chiropractic in 1946, we insure close to 40,000 DCs today. However, NCMIC is so much more. NCMIC provides credit card processing, equipment loans, a business credit card, as well as property and casualty insurance and long-term disability coverage. Since 1996, NCMIC has also contributed over $13 million towards research and education specifically for chiropractic, and we've returned more than $124 million in premium dividends to DC policyholders. As you look for your financial products or insurance needs for your practice or your home, I'd like to ask that you consider NCMIC. We as a profession owe it to ourselves to support those who support us. And NCMIC and its employees truly live by our motto, "We take care of our own." And now what you've been waiting for. Each year, Dr. Sportelli seeks outstanding talent worldwide to provide the keynote address of our plenary session. Last year, Dr. Marianne Jennings provided thoughtful insight into ethical dilemmas. This morning, we continue that tradition with Roger Hall, PhD. Dr. Hall received his undergraduate and doctor in psychology from The Ohio State University and is a member of Phi Beta Kappa. In 1993, he founded Compass Consultation Limited, where he works with professionals, executives, business owners to improve their lives and performance. His experience ranges from small entrepreneurial organizations to Fortune 20 companies. To quote Roger, "I like working with people who want to become better versions of themselves." Please join me in welcoming Roger Hall.
Thank you, Wayne. Good morning. I am grateful to be here. I am Dr. Roger Hall. I am a business psychologist. People ask me all the time, what is a business psychologist? That means I come to your office and you lay on your own couch. Okay, it's not a very good joke, so that's all right. I'm very grateful to be here today. I am a guest of NCMIC with whom I've worked for probably 2 or 3 years. Grateful to be here, grateful to be part of the FCA experience. Thank you, Jennifer Poro, for organizing such a great event. What I want to talk to you today about is information overload and decision fatigue. But I start all of my talks by saying this one thing, which is education without execution is just entertainment. Education without execution is just entertainment, which I stole from a guy named Jay Sanders, who wrote a book called Love is the Killer App. And what I know about business education is we spend billions each year training people in events like this, where guys like me stand up here We spend billions of dollars doing, I don't make billions, but we spend billions of dollars doing this, and I know that you will forget 90% of what I say here today within 90 days. So within 3 months, all you're going to remember about me is, oh, yeah, guy, he wasn't so bad. You don't remember most of the content. And the reason you don't remember most of the content is you try to remember too much stuff. Here's how it works at these events. You come in here and you're trying to get as much information as you can. So you start writing down notes and you take notes down and then you get home and you've got your packet of stuff from the convention and you put it on your desk and you say, this Friday I'm going to go through that stuff and I'm going to work on that. And so Friday comes around and between the time you get back from the convention and Friday occurs, there are like three or four things that you put on your notebook from the FCA convention. And so you get to Friday and you start working on those things, and then the weekend comes, and then next week comes, and there are more things on the stack, and then 6 months from now you're looking at your desk and say, man, this is a disaster. And so you put it in a file cabinet with the intention that 6 months from now, after that, you're going to go through your file cabinet and you're going to work on that stuff because you got really, really great good ideas from this conference. And then it's in the file cabinet, and then when you move your office 27 years from now, you pull it out and you say, oh yeah, I remember that. Boom, and you throw it away. That's what happens to most business education. So the thing I want you to remember is education without execution is just entertainment. How many of you guys made New Year's resolutions in January? Like 8 of you, or just only 8 of you are willing to admit it? Okay? Do you know what the problem with New Year's resolutions is? It's the letter S. New Year's resolutions. If you make one New Year's resolution, you are far more likely to do it than if you do multiple New Year's resolutions. The reason we stop our New Year's resolutions by February is we're trying to do too many. So what I want you to remember today is choose one thing from what I say today that you will apply today. If you don't just choose one thing, if you go, no, I'm pretty smart, I can choose two. No. Just choose one. Now, so that you remember this, I'm going to tell you a story. How many of you guys have ever been to the circus? Do you guys ever been to the circus? Okay, more than 8. That's good. Okay, so you've been to the circus. You guys see the lion tamer. You guys, okay, so the lion tamer walks into the cage, and in this hand he carries a whip, which totally makes sense. He's going to whip the lions, that makes sense. And in this hand he carries a chair, which makes absolutely no sense. Unless, of course, lions have like a preternatural fear of chairs. They have little support groups on the savannah. I had a bad dream about a chair. And so he brings this chair in, and it's never a sturdy chair. Have you noticed it? It's one of those little lightweight bentwood things with a wicker bottom. What is it about this chair? Now, what I'm about to tell you may not be true, but it's such a good story, I have to tell it, which is lions know what to do with one stick sticking in their face. They bat it away. When there are two sticks sticking in their face, they know what to do with that. They bat it away. But when there are four sticks sticking in their face, it confuses them enough and it delays them enough that it allows the lion tamer to guide them. And I really, in every one of my talks, I do my best to insult everyone in the room. So here's your chance. Ready? You're not that much different than animals. You think you can remember four things, you can really only remember one. So today, remember one thing. Try to pick out one thing from what we're going to talk about today. So when I go into an organization, and I've had the good fortune to work with all different kinds of organizations around the country, they say, we want better results. Roger, come in and help us get better results. Work with our people, help us get better results. And I ask the logical question, where do better results come from? And they say, we know better results come from imitating the best practices of the leading companies around the world, and we've read all these books, and we're going to imitate their best practices. And so what they tell me is that in order to get better results, they need to have different actions, different behaviors. And I say, that's awesome. You're really a genius. Now tell me, where do better actions and behaviors come from? At which point, they look like Lassie. They don't know. Where do better actions and behaviors come from? Better actions and behaviors come from better thinking. My one trick is this. I train leaders to monitor and manage their thinking. Excellent, disciplined performers in every area of life, be it in entertainment, be it in medicine, healthcare, business, are all first and foremost disciplined thinkers. And if you want to be great at your job in the business of helping people get better as chiropractors, your job is to become first a disciplined thinker. You need to change your pattern of thinking. And I don't mean Minza Sudoku kind of thinking. I mean monitoring and managing your thinking. And people ask me, okay, so how does that work? How do we do that? And there's a big distinction between knowing how to do something and doing it. So let me give you an example. What's the biggest healthcare problem in the United States? Number one healthcare problem in the United States. So, loud and proud. All I hear now is obesity. Obesity is the number one healthcare problem in the United States. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to give you the formula for losing weight in 5 seconds. You ready? So about 20 years ago, do you guys remember when Letterman was on NBC? And then he left NBC, took about 6 months off, and then moved over to CBS. Well, when he was at NBC, he had gained a lot of weight. And while he was off, he had lost weight. So he's on CBS this morning with Paula Zahn, and she's interviewing him, and he's looking pretty trim. And she says, "Dave, you look great. What's your secret?" And he says, "You ready to write this down?" He says, "I eat less and I exercise more." She says, "How do you feel?" He says, "Hungry all the time." Right there, I have told you the formula for losing weight. You eat less and exercise more. How do you feel? Hungry all the time. Boom, we're done. How easy is that? We know the behavior we need to do in order to lose weight. However, eating is not primarily a behavioral issue. Eating is primarily a decision-making issue. Let me give you an example. This morning, I had my standard breakfast when I'm out on the road, which is 2 eggs scrambled, cheese, salsa, orange juice, cup of coffee. 5 things. I never go to the buffet. Do you know why I never go to the buffet? Because then I have to make decisions about what I do. Here's what you need to know about eating and everything else in your life. We all have a daily decisional load. If I was to ask you all to drop and give me 100 push-ups, some of you could do it, most of you couldn't. And at some point, you would reach your daily push-up load. At that point, you could do no more push-ups. And if I said, "Give me 5 more push-ups, you'd say, "Stop it, I can't do 5 more push-ups. Because you will have hit your daily push-up load. Tomorrow, if I came back and said, "Give me another 100 push-ups, you could do more push-ups. Why? Because you had rested. The same is true with decision making. Every day you have a daily decisional load on decisions. All day long you're at work making decisions with your patients, with your coworkers, with your employees. And at the end of the day, you get home and there you are in the kitchen with your loved one. And you say, "What do you want to eat?" And you and your loved one, "I don't know, what do you want to eat? I don't know. What's in the refrigerator?" You open it up, "Well, I got pork chops from yesterday. That doesn't sound good. What else we got?" "I don't know." "What's in the freezer?" "Oh, we got frozen chicken, but then we'll have to cut up vegetables and choose spices and figure out what we're going to have with it." You guys know this, right? I'm the only one this happens. And then there's something at your refrigerator right now that saves you. Do you know what it is? Ice cream. I like that answer. It's at your refrigerator right there. It's the pizza magnet. And you're there looking in the freezer. You go, "I don't know, you want pizza?" "Yeah, that sounds good." So you call, and then, "You want your regular?" "Yes." Okay? So what you've done, the reason we have a problem with obesity in the United States is that people are worn out and they choose the easiest route, whatever's convenient, whatever takes no decisions. Eating in a healthy way requires a great deal of decision making. The reason Jenny Craig works so well is they come into your house and take all your food and you make no more decisions about your food. And the reason that you need to think about information overload is because every day we are being inundated with information and decisions and we are worn out. In the morning, you are far more able to make good decisions than later in the day. If you have proper nutrition, you are able to make better decisions when you have enough glucose in your brain to make those decisions. There was an interesting study of judges in Israel. So I'm here for you. I'm going to give. In case any of you are arrested and imprisoned in Israel, keep this in mind. They studied judges' parole hearings in Israel, and they found that judges at 10 in the morning, when someone came up for parole, only 10% got paroled. 90%, they said, stay in prison. After lunch, in a protein-rich lunch, parole rates went to 65%. So if you're ever arrested and imprisoned in Israel, make sure your lawyer gets an after-lunch parole hearing. The reason is the judges had gotten decision fatigued in the morning. Their brain had run out of glucose. Your body takes in food, converts it to glucose. Your brain occupies 3 to 5% of your body mass, but uses 20% of the glucose in your food. Your brain is an overuser of the energy from your food. We say we eat for healthy heart, bones, and muscles, but really you're eating for your brain so that you can think well. And we are decision fatigued every day. You know it, you feel it. Next time you're at the refrigerator and you can't figure out what you want to eat, tell yourself, I'm decision fatigued. I'm overloaded. And part of our problem in the healthcare profession, in the legal profession, in all different professions, is we have tremendous amounts of information that we're trying to consume. There's a syndrome they're now calling information fatigue syndrome. There's a wonderful quote that says, there's been an alarming increase in things I know nothing about. I have one teenager and two in their 20s, my kids, and every day I learn things I know nothing about. The rate of information flow has increased so fast. We now have technology that produces information faster than we can consume it. There's a quote that I love, which is, we use the analogy of the brain, we use the analogy of the computer to understand the brain, but we don't realize our brains aren't wired to multitask. How many of you in the last 2 weeks have said, I'm multitasking? Okay? Mostly women, okay? So here we are. We tell ourselves that we're wired to multitask. Actually, your brain is wired to multitask. You can walk and chew gum at the same time. That's multitasking. You can knit and watch TV. That's multitasking. Because you're using different parts of the brain to do different things. So if you're knitting, you're using the motor cortex, the parietal cortex, not a lot of the prefrontal cortex. If you're watching TV, well, you're just not using any of it. But so you can do those things at the same time. But when you're multitasking, as we describe it, here's what you're doing. You're sitting at your desk, clicka, 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 answering an email, the phone rings, and you, And then somebody comes to your door, you go, no, I'm listening. Okay, now by the way, how many of you guys think you're really getting away with this? I mean, you don't think the person on the phone knows you're doing this? I guarantee you, I am better at acting interested in things that I don't care about than anyone in this room. I have a 5-year postgraduate degree in saying, so what I hear you saying is, tell me more. I feel your pain. I'm really good at this. I've got lots of experience doing it. So I'm answering an email, and my daughter, who at the time was 5 years old, I'm going, And she says, what you doing? I said, talking to you. And she says, what else you doing? It's like, I mean, I'm an expert at saying, And if a 5-year-old can catch me, don't you think they can catch you? And a lot of you go, and like, by the way, don't you think they can hear the keyboard? And so I know some of you, you do this. You go, you do real quiet, right? You know you do it. We think we can do that. So this is what we're multitasking. You're not really multitasking. You're single tasking with rapid shifts in attention. But before I go there, I need to say this thing. How many of you are saying to yourself, it's mostly the women, saying, well, you're a man. Of course you can't multitask, right? Women, the research is really clear. Women are better at multitasking than men. So here's my question. Ladies, you know how bad we are at multitasking. So congratulations, you're one better than suck. I mean, we know we're no good at this. I mean, you put a man in a room with a television and another person. I mean, we know we're bad at multitasking, so you're one better than us. And actually, the reality, and I know you're saying, well, we use a whole brain, and it's we've got more corpus callosum with both hemispheres of the brain communicating. Yeah, we know that. But the newer research is really clear that women are not that much better than men at multitasking. And when you're multitasking, you're really single tasking with rapid shifts in attention. So there you are, you're sitting at your keyboard answering the email with the phone at your ear, directing traffic at the door. And you think you're doing it all at the same time. No, you're not. You're focused on the email, and then you shift with a rapid shift in attention to the phone, then back to the email, then to the door, then to the phone. People are telling me all the time, Doc, I can't remember things anymore. I'm having trouble remembering people's names, numbers. I just can't bring it all together. Maybe I have Alzheimer's. And I say, well, maybe you do, because I have a really great bedside manner. But I say, far more likely, you're information overloaded. We're seeing memory deficits and concentration deficits because people aren't getting into a deep level of concentration. When you begin to concentrate, you have a shallow level of concentration. You guys know this. You guys, when you were at the library, when you were studying, you'd go into the library, right? And you'd get in that study carrel, and you'd get your books out, and you'd sit down, and you'd start writing, or you start working on something, and then like 2 study carrels over, you hear, and you're like, oh, man, go take some medicine, do something, get away from me, I don't want to catch that. It's like, okay, focus, concentrate, and you get back to your work, okay, and then like 3 study carrels down, you hear, and you're like, oh, I should have brought Purell, oh, God, okay, so focus, and you start working again, and then you hear the chair move, and you look, and you go, ooh, that's worth looking at. And you linger. Oh, that was just me. Okay, so and then you get back to work. So you have this shallow level of concentration where you can't focus on anything. And then there's this transition point. You guys remember that? Where you transition into that deep level of concentration where no sound, no noise, nothing takes you away from what you're doing. Do you guys remember that? Have you ever experienced that where you're one with the work? You're in the zone. It's called flow. And you can learn more about this experience where you're concentrating on a challenging problem. And when you're at this deep level of concentration, how do you feel? It feels good. You lose a sense, your sense of time, and you join with the work. That sense of flow is really wonderful. And then there's a point at which you lose your concentration and you get a shallow level of concentration and you can't think about anything anymore. And we do our best thinking in that deep level of concentration when we're not able to be distracted by anything else. And when you're single tasking with rapid shifts in attention, here's what happens. You start on the email, and then you shift your attention back up to the phone, and then you start on the phone conversation, and you shift your attention back up, and you're at a shallow level of concentration all day long. You're exhausted because you're constantly shifting your attention from one thing to another. Email is the devil. You know, we all get like 200 emails a day, right? And we spend so much time processing it. And what we're doing is rapid shifts in attention, quick decision making, rapid shifts in attention for lots and lots of superficial tasks. There was an interesting study done in London. And they took a group of people. They tested their IQ. They had equal average IQs. They split them into two groups. One group, they had answer emails for 2 hours. And they retested their IQ. And the other group had smoked some righteous weed and get stoned out of their minds. And they retested them in 2 hours. What did they find? The email group, who was multitasking, their level of intelligence testing went down. Their ability to solve cognitive problems decreased. What do you think happened to the people who smoked weed? Yeah, I know, you guys all want to say that. No, it didn't go up. It went down, but it didn't go down as much as answering email. In other words, your cognitive performance is more negatively affected each day by answering emails for 2 hours than it is getting stoned. Now, the moral of the story is not get stoned instead of answering your email, and definitely the moral is not get stoned while you're answering your emails. But what it is saying is that if people are intoxicated, that is less damaging to our ability to solve cognitive problems than trying to multitask. We are trying to multitask all the time. There's a great book by David Shank called Data Smog. It came out in 1999. The book is now 16 years old. And in it, he argues that our technology is moving so fast, we can't keep up with the rate of change, that our technology produces information faster than we can consume it. He says that the average person in 16th century England could expect to consume in his or her lifetime the amount of written information contained in one single issue of the New York Times. What you expect to read by breakfast is what a person 400, 500 years ago could expect to read in his or her life. Our brains have not evolved that fast in 500 years to consume this much information. We are not designed to take in this much information. And what are the symptoms of data smog? We get so much information, it causes lots and lots of problems. Here are the symptoms. We make more mistakes. We misunderstand one another more. We snap at our coworkers. We make flawed conclusions, foolish decisions, analysis paralysis. Then we move into the health problems, sleep disorders, impaired concentration, weakened immune system, indigestion, heart problems, hypertension, blah, blah, blah. The list goes on. We're trying to consume so much information, it's making us sick. So let me give you an example. How many of you guys have ever been to Chuck E. Cheese? Okay, let me ask the question differently. How many of you guys have been to Chuck E. Cheese without kids involved because it sounded like a fun night out? What is wrong with you? Okay? So my kids are older now, but when they were little, I had really well-behaved kids, and so we'd go to Chuck E. Cheese for someone's birthday party, and my well-behaved kids would go in, right? And then what would happen? They'd walk through the door, and it's like, woo, whack-a-mole, whack-a-mole, oh my gosh, tickets, 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 woo, a ball pool, let me jump in, and you know, and, oh, look at that, trails, a singing rat. You know, I mean, so they're really going wild, and then 2 hours later, we leave, and my well-behaved kids have turned into screaming monster children. Now, some of you are going, you know, it's the red food coloring and it's all the sugar. Hey, if I had fed them rice cakes and water for 2 hours, they would have come out the same way, you know? And so we'd stop on the way home to pick up some stuff from Target, and I'd be walking around Target with my kids. They're like, ah! And people go, you need to do something about your kids. So we stopped. Now, I said to my kids, unless there's a blood oath involved, we're never going to Chuck E. Cheese again. Now here's the issue. My well-behaved kids turned into screaming monster children. What do we say happens when we go to Chuck E. Cheese with our kids? We say our kids are overstimulated. Ladies and gentlemen, we have turned our offices into Chuck E. Cheese. There you are, you're working on something, and then what happens? Let's say you're at your desk, you're at your complete computer, you're working on, you know, a report, and it's going really well. And then Microsoft, because they're so generous, have decided they want to help you understand when an email comes in. So as you're typing, then Outlook goes, boop, and you can't help yourself. Must look at email. Must click. It's like Christmas Day. I wonder what's in there. There could be like a prize. Maybe there's a dollar. And so you feel you need to click it. Guess what's happened? You've gone from a deep level of concentration on the project you're working on, boop, to check the thing. Every time your phone rings, every time a text message comes through, every time you get an email notification, all of those keep you from concentrating. Every time somebody comes to your door, all of that affects your ability to concentrate. Do you know how long? You know, you'll have an associate come in and they go, hey, this will only take 5 minutes. Do you know what they're really saying? It'll only take me 5 minutes to ask my question, but it'll take you 20 minutes to get back to the level of concentration you were in. So if you have people coming in interrupting you every 20 minutes, what happens to your level of concentration? You never have a deep level of concentration on anything. Your best thinking comes when you have no interruption. Why do we have our best ideas in the shower? Because nobody's bothering us, unless you have a three-year-old. I gotta go to potty, you know. But you have your best ideas in the shower because there's no one bothering you, and most of you already know how to do it. Don't tell me if you don't know how to take a shower. You have to think your way through it. But we are inundated with information. It's wearing us out, and we're overstimulated. We're becoming irritable. We're nasty to our coworkers. We're starting to have health problems because of it. So let's talk about, where does this problem come from? The first is we have an acceleration in our society. Our society has accelerated to a speed that's hard to keep up with. Now, I'm going to give you examples from the grocery store for these things. And the reason I do that is every one of you have been to the grocery store. And I don't know what your occupational hazard is, but my occupational hazard is this. I believe God has created everyone on this planet for my entertainment. So when I go to the grocery store and I come back, my family doesn't say, what'd you buy? They say, what happened this time? Because there's always some, I mean, to me, that's like going to the fair. You know, I walk slowly down the aisles to see what I'm going to see. So I'm at the grocery store one day, and we now have accelerated so fast that we use money to give the appearance that we have time. So I'm driving up to the grocery store. My daughter has fallen asleep in her car seat. She was little at this point. And I pull up, and what do you do with a kid who's in the car seat, who's fallen asleep? You stay in the car. You don't wake the kid up, because then it's just like my trip to Target. I've got a screaming monster child, and people say, you need to do something about that kid. And I can't leave her in the car because, you know, last time the SWAT team came. That's a lie. I didn't leave her in the car. So there she is. She's asleep in her car seat. So I pull up, and I decide I'm going to get a good spot. So I pull up so I can see people walking past. And there I am. I'm watching people go in and out of the grocery store. And there's this guy. He walks out. He's got two shopping carts. He's got one in front of him, one behind him. It's kind of like a shopping cart train. And he's walking along like this. And he pulls up behind this white SUV. No, it wasn't OJ. He pulls down the tailgate. And he pulls out a giant igloo cooler he's just bought. He rips the tags off, opens it up, pours two bags of ice in it, gets a bunch of juice boxes, puts the juice boxes in, gets them dug into the ice, and then pushes the cooler into the bed of the SUV. Then he goes to the next cart and he pulls out 15 Rubbermaid food storage containers, rips the tags off all those, opens them up, lays them out smorgasbord style on the back of his tailgate. At this point, I'm going, don't wake up, don't wake up. I got to see how this ends. Move. What's going on here? And I'm watching him. And then what does he do? He goes back to that second cart, and he pulls out 15 deli containers full of food he's just bought at the deli. He opens those up, pours them into the Rubbermaid containers, throws the deli containers away, seals up the Rubbermaid containers, puts them in the cooler, drives off. What's he doing? He's going to a soccer picnic, and he's just spent $250 on containers to give everyone the impression that he did what? Made it himself. Now, why do I tell you that it's a white SUV? Because I told this story once. A woman came up to me and said, what color was the SUV? And I said, it was white. She goes, you sure it wasn't red? And I said, no, it wasn't red. She goes, because I went on a girl's weekend away with my friends, and I came back, and my husband, who drives a red SUV, had bought a cooler and 15 Rubbermaid food storage containers for a soccer picnic. Now, you know this happens, that we're spending money now to give the impression that we made it ourselves. We are so low on time. We are time-starved, so we're throwing money at things for convenience. So we use money to give the appearance that we have time. Second, everything is now urgent. Everything is now urgent. So there I am. I'm in the grocery store. I'm walking down the salad dressing aisle. I'm going to pick up some balsamic vinaigrette, and right across from the salad dressing is the pickle display. And there's a guy. He's doing the standard guy pose. He's doing this. He's looking at the pickles, and then he makes the move. You've done it. You know it. He makes the move. Hey, babe. Yeah. Yeah. I'm in front of the pickles. Yeah. Did you want the kosher dills or the deli dills? At this point, you know, like suddenly the balsamic vinaigrette ingredients are really interesting. You guys are thinking I'm really creepy, but I don't care. So I'm watching this guy, and he goes, yeah, kosher dills or deli dills? He said, kosher, got it. So do you want the big jar or the little jar? Big jar? Okay, good. So do you want them whole or sliced? Yeah, well, they got the half slice, they got the quarter slice, they got the hamburger slice. And then they got those new long hamburger slice. Yeah, like they slice it like long way. And it's like, it's like a little, you know, it's like they slice it and it's wet. You have to see it. Yeah. You want them whole? Oh, I could get two. Oh, okay. Yeah, love you too. I'm not making this part up. I'll call you on aisle 7. Bye, click. Like she's at home. You know, she's managing her day. Okay, he'll call me in 5 more minutes on aisle 7 because there's another dilemma. Now everything is urgent. Everything we do is now urgent. You know, 40 years ago, who had cell phones? Brain surgeons, heart surgeons, doctors, someone's dying. Now everyone has a cell phone. We've got to consult. Kosher dills or deli dills? Now you know this happens in your workplace, right? You're planning the Christmas party and someone says, so, what color Solo cups should we have? Should we have red or green? Or do you want to mix it up? And they send out an email, and then somebody CCs everyone back and says, what about blue ones for the people who celebrate Hanukkah? And so then everybody gets the CC on that one, and then somebody comes up with a genius idea, hey, let's do a Survey Monkey. Okay, so everybody vote on what color Solo... This happened in your office? Yeah. So we're going to do a Survey Monkey. What color... It's like, really? Now, because it's so easy to communicate, everything is an urgent decision, and no one wants to decide. Everybody's pushing it off so that they can get everybody's vote on it. And your email inbox is full of stuff that's been CC'd 18 times for ridiculous things you don't need to know about. Am I the only one this happens to? You're all overwhelmed with information. And because everything is an urgent decision, everything is important, and as a result, we're all delaying our decision-making. No one is deciding. The last thing is, because we can, we think we should. In the acceleration of our society, because we can, we think we should. Do you guys remember blue laws? Do you remember when the grocery store used to close? Saturday night, you'd be in front of the refrigerator, and what would you be doing? You'd be looking to see what was in there, and you'd realize you were out of milk, and you'd say, I guess we're having toast for breakfast. Close the door, go to bed. Now, 10 o'clock Saturday night, you open the refrigerator, and you say, oh, we're out of milk. What's the next thing that comes out of your mouth? What else do we need from the store? And so you run to the store, you pick up milk and Twinkies and, you know, whatever else is, you know, by the cash register. And so we're buying bad food because we're doing these things because we're able to. Because we can, we think we should. I got a phone call. The voice stamp on my voicemail said 9:40 p.m. from a lawyer calling me about a case. And he asked me something at 9:40 at night on a Wednesday night. What should he have been doing at 9:40 on a Wednesday night? Spending time with his family. Why was he thinking about me? Well, because there is no natural limit to when work ends. I love my work, and I work a lot because I like my work. But if we get to the point where there are no natural, clear-cut delineations of when work ends and when rest begins, we will work into forever. Because we can, we think we should. We all tell ourselves the Los Angeles lie. Anybody from LA here? Okay, I went out to LA once when I was in my 20s, and I said, how long does it take to get from Huntington Beach to La Brea? And the person said, oh, it's like 20 minutes. Yeah, at midnight in a helicopter. With traffic, it's like 3 hours. So the Los Angeles lie is this. We tell ourselves all the time, it'll only take us 20 minutes. So you get home, you get dinner that you buy from Pizza Hut, you get the kids' homework set up, and then you say, I'm just gonna answer a couple emails. It'll only take 20 minutes. And then how long does it take? 3 hours later at midnight, you're still working on emails. We tell ourselves the Los Angeles lie. It'll only take me 20 minutes. Because we can, we think we should. There are no natural limits to when we rest. So acceleration of our society is a problem. The second major point is our society, and if we can show the slides here, is becoming increasingly complex. We have a lot more complexity in our society. Back in the 1920s, when everyone wore hats and everyone looked the same and dressed the same and looked the same, the name Romanowski was an ethnic name. Now, Srinivasan Balasubrahmanyan is an ethnic name. The fact that Romanowski was Catholic mattered then. Now, it's like, eh, whatever. Now, Srinivasan, that he worships Ganesha while the rest of his family worships Krishna, that you have to know. That's fine. Our society has changed. Look, we have all kinds of different people. If you look at baseball now, except, boy, that guy really took it, didn't he? We have different colors, different races, different ethnic groups. Look at that guy. What a reaction. Grabbed it on the fly. Everybody now looks different. Hey, I like the fact that we have different cultures, different races, different ethnicities, different religions. I like the variety pack of our society. But all of it requires us to think and decide more, all of which cuts into our daily decisional load. We need that excess so that we can handle all the complexity of people. We have more choices in our society. Ladies, you know exactly what this is. Men, this looks like a complicated logarithmic table. Now, as you look at this, we have choices about everything. Ladies, you know exactly what this is. Men, I'll inform you. Men, this is the pantyhose sizing chart. The moral of this story is, ladies, never send a man to do a job only a woman is qualified to do. You need to know that these choices are all fraught with moral peril. At a different season in my life, I was sent to the store late on a Saturday night to pick up hose, and there I am. I'm doing this. And there are two other guys doing the same thing. I hope they were buying for their spouses. And I'm looking at it. And ladies, you need to know, we only have one variable that is not fraught with moral peril, and that is the y-axis. On the y-axis, we have height. Ladies, this is how we know how tall you are. You will actually see men doing this. They're doing a little mental math. Okay, she's 5'4". Got it. Okay. So we got the y-axis. What's the x-axis? Oh, no. Fraught with moral peril. And there you're looking at it and you go, okay, she's in the B, but what if she's close to C? Which one should I get? Because if you come home with the B and it's too small, you're going to have to go out again and she'll be in tears. If you get the C, moral peril. What do you think? I'm this fat? Okay, so you've got a big problem. And that's not it. That's just the two variables. Then you've got brand. You figure out the brand. Fine, you got that done. Then you've got color. Ladies, we men were issued the 8 box of crayons. You got the 128 box. Every woman in this room knows what the color ecru is. The men are leaning over. Isn't that a bird that can't fly from New Zealand? We don't know what these colors are. And so there we are looking at these colors, and we think tan and nude ought to be the same thing. They're not. And then we think black should be black. We know what that looks like, right? But then they name it different things like midnight, and then they translate it noir. Like, we have to know French to buy this? Oh, I'm going to screw up. And then you've got sandal toe versus non-sandal toe. It's February, and you're wondering, will they wear out by the time she's wearing sandals? I don't know. And then you've got the other things, which is she wants you to be supportive. Is that the kind you're supposed to get? She wants you to treat her like a queen. Is that the kind you're supposed to get? And then there's the, I mean, every man knows what XXL means, right? But then there's this thing called XXL petite. How does that happen? I know exactly what that looks like. I had a woman come up to me afterwards. She goes, see this? And I go, yeah. And she goes, this is XXL petite. I go, got it. Seared in my memory. I won't forget. But here we are. Every day we're filling up our brains with tiny little decisions, fraught with moral peril. Tiny little decisions, all of which consume our daily decisional load. So the more decisions you're making on little things, like whether you should get the almond peanut butter or the regular peanut butter, all of those things add up and they make it more and more difficult to decide on the most important things. When you're deciding on a treatment option for one of your patients or your clients, if you filled your head and made so many decisions, your brain is worn out. It's consumed all the glucose to make those silly decisions. And you don't have enough left over to make the good decisions for your clients. We have so many choices in our society, and it's not just pantyhose, it's everything. We have choices everywhere. Have you ever had somebody paint your house? You ever have a painter come in and they bring that vision from hell, the cards? You remember the paint chips? It's like, here, pick a color. You pick. Well, it's not my house. It's like, I can't do this because there's too many choices. And what we know is when people have too many choices, they don't make a choice. There was a company that made jellies. And they had these esoteric jellies like guava, habanero, and mango, chipotle. They had grape and they had strawberry too. And they put 18 samples out on a Saturday morning for people to taste. And they marked every time somebody tasted the thing. And what did they find? A lot of people tasted their jelly. Then they looked at the receipts from the cash registers to find out how many people bought their jelly. What did they find? Nobody bought the jelly, because there were too many choices. When they limited the choices from 18 to 4 or 5, the same number of people bought the jellies, but then what happened? Sales went up. If you have patients coming in and you outline 47 different treatment options for them, do you know how many they're going to decide on? They won't be back. They are expecting you to decide for them. Our job as professionals is not just about the physical stuff that we do. You folks adjust people, you make decisions about that, but they're expecting you to decide what is best for them and give them a few treatment options. But if you give them 47, they're not going to know what to do. That's your job. And if you're consuming your daily decisional load with stupid stuff, then you can't help your patients. We have more change in our work life. If you can show this slide, The first slide is a slide of an office in the 1940s. The second is a shot from an office in the 1990s. Now, the new offices have less paper. Isn't that wonderful? Now we have terabytes and terabytes of data that we can't find, so we have to hire an IT consulting company to figure out how to do the database queries to find that record. We've just changed from paper to electronic data, but we are collecting so much data we can't find it anymore. And work life has changed so that now Americans are working more than any other country in the world. We work more than the French, which is not a big surprise. We work more than the Italians. We work more than the Australians, who have like 3 months off every year. We work more than the Japanese. And in fact, ladies and gentlemen, Americans work 168 hours a year more than we worked 30 years ago. That's the equivalent of one work month a year. We're working 13 months a year now. We're working more, and we're not more effective. Why? Because our decisional load is down. Doing less stuff, but more effectively by concentrating and quieting your head, that's what will make you excellent at making decisions. So what's the marker of success? Darwin is widely misquoted as saying, only the strong survive. He never said it. In fact, he said, it is not the strongest of the species that survive, nor the most intelligent, but the one most responsive to change. You need to look at the way technology is speeding up your life and how your willingness to embrace technology has made your life go faster, and you've got to adapt to the change. You're the person to do this. You're the one who can be most adaptive to change. So then how do you reduce your information overload? How do you get past this? I used to work with people who were obsessive, compulsive hoarders, clutterers, pack rats. And they all believed that if I bought Rubbermaid storage boxes and those Sterilite drawers, then I could get this stuff organized. It never worked. Better organization never works. What's a product that Rubbermaid makes that will really help you? A trash can. Sift and trash. We are gathering way too much information. What we know about decision making is that when you give a person more variables, it actually decreases their decision quality. I'm going to assume all of you are, you know, average knowledge on cars. If I was to give you all a Craigslist ad for 8 cars with 3 variables for each of the cars, which is, you know, low miles, you know, 145,000 miles, one owner, no accidents, you know, versus air conditioning works well, leather interior, new tires. You could, with those variables, rank the best to the worst car as amateurs with the same level of accuracy that professional mechanics would do it. When we increase the number of variables from 3 to, say, 10 or 11 for each car, what happens to your ability to rank order the quality of cars? You go to random. Mechanics can still do it, but your ability goes random. The more information you try to take in, the more variables you try to take in, it actually decreases your decision quality. So when you become expert in an area, you start to see more and more data and filter it to what's most critical. When you've been experienced in your field, you can watch a person walk in, and so many variables fall away, and you only focus on the most central pieces of information. And as you try to take in more and more pieces of information, your decision quality actually goes down. So as you become expert in your field, you need less and less information in order to make a good decision. So how do you improve? The first is you sift and trash. Let me give an example from my home. Like many of you, you get the mail, which I call the trash delivery service. You get the mail from the mailbox, and I walk through my garage, what do I have next to the door that goes into the laundry room? I have a trash can. And those of you who are green, I also have a recycling bin. So I start throwing things away, right? I don't even get into the house and I've already thrown away most of the junk mail. And those of you who are security-minded say, you need to shred that. What do I have immediately inside the laundry room? A shredder. So by the time I'm into the living area of my house, I've already sifted and trashed most of that information. For you, a great deal of information is coming through your phone. Have an IT person teach you how to set up your Outlook so that lots and lots of this information immediately goes to the junk file or goes to another file that you don't have to look at it. I encourage people to say, have a file called CC. Do you know what that stands for? When anybody CCs you anything, it immediately goes to that file because apparently you're not the primary recipient and you probably don't need to read it. So once a week, you can go through the CC file and throw most of it out. By the way, do you guys remember what CC used to mean? Carbon copy. That meant that physics was the actual limit to how many people could get a copy of a thing. So you had a paper, a carbon, another piece of paper, maybe another carbon, another piece of paper, and you'd crank it in the typewriter and you'd press the keys really hard and you could have the original and two copies. Now you can CC everyone in your organization. So what I encourage you is sift and trash, set it up so that the CCs go to their own file. You probably don't have to look at it. Instruct your staff. Don't CC me on anything until I have to decide. Don't give me an FYI anything. I don't want that. Sift the information before it even comes to you. Have a person whose job it is to decide what information gets to you and what information doesn't. The second is set limits. Set limits on the amount of time you're going to spend solving a problem, consuming information, and stick to it. What we know is if you're working on a project, you know what you're going to do? You're going to keep working, working, working until you get an A. You're going to work, and you know what? You can get 80% of it done in 20% of the time. It's the Pareto principle, the 80-20 rule. 80% of the value comes in 20% of the work. So in 20% of the time, you can get yourself, what's an 80? It's a B. You can get a B. And the world was run on people who get Bs. You know, I'm not a big believer in A students. Even though I was a good student, the world is run on the B students. So spend 20% of the time, get yourself a B, and then move on to another project. It doesn't have to be perfect. It just has to be done. The next is respond on your own time. Respond on your own time. If you get a text, how long till you answer that text? Somebody shout it out, ballpark it. Instantly, immediately, seconds. Okay, let's say you get an email, how long till you answer that? A day, okay? Let's say you get a voicemail, how long till you answer that? Somebody call it out real loud. A day. Let's say you get an unregistered letter in the U.S. mail. How long does it take you to answer that? Be honest, never. Right? So what we have are four different means that the information has been transmitted. What if it's the same information in each of those means? What you've done is you've allowed the means by which the information gets to you to regulate the speed of your response. So what will your clients and patients do? If they send you a letter and you never respond, they'll call and leave a voicemail. If it doesn't happen fast enough, they'll email you. If it doesn't happen fast enough, they'll text you. And because you respond to texts in seconds, guess what you've just done? You've trained them to skip the mail, the phone, the email, just text me. And then what happens? You get texts from everybody all the time, and you're back to being information overloaded. So set limits on how long you're going to take to respond and respond on your own time. The next is relax while you're waiting for technology. How many of you guys cuss at your computer? As it's firing up, oh, it's a piece of junk, I swear. Ever since we updated, it's just as slow as molasses. These things are junk. Or when you're waiting for the copy machine to turn on, Why doesn't anybody turn on the copier? I don't have time for this. This may be the only time in your day that you can slow down and enjoy your day. So wait for the technology, you know, relax while you wait for the technology. The next is use technologies that work for you. If you can run your life on a calendar that has puppies and kittens and a dumb phone and a yellow pad of paper, live well, enjoy your life. Just because there's new technology that's come out doesn't mean it's right for you. I had a BlackBerry for 27 days. Do you know why I had a BlackBerry for 27 days? Because the return policy at the time was 30 days, and I just couldn't figure out how to use it. I was no good at that technology. I work with a gentleman who has earned his company over $2 billion in his career. That's with a B. And he's one of the people I coach, and he says, you know, a lot of people are going to iPads to manage their calendar. And he's got those one of those old month-at-a-glance calendars, big thing. It's, you know, covered with chicken scratch. And he says, I think I got to switch because I'm really behind the time. And I said, in your company, what's your ranking for sales for your company? And he goes, I don't know. It depends on, you know, the week, one or two. And I said, so you're either number one or number two salesperson in your company. You've raised $2 billion, more than $2 billion for your company. And you think you're doing something wrong? You're right. So now he still carries his paper calendar, even though all the cool kids are using an iPad. So what I want to tell you is if it's an effective means for you, use technology that works for you. Just because it's new doesn't mean it's better. It doesn't mean it'll work for you. And guess what happens when new technology comes in? You have to learn how to use it, which requires more decisions, all of which create fatigue. The next is schedule time away from information. When was the last time you went on a vacation and shut down your work email? Where you didn't answer work emails, where you didn't watch television, where you didn't plug into the internet. When was the last time you guys did this? Last month, congratulations. You know, a couple times a year I try to take 3 days where I do a technology fast, a quiet retreat. And it's amazing how much you can think when you don't have technology around. I worked with a guy once. He was going to go on a safari in Tanzania. And nobody asked him, are you worried about sleeping sickness? Are you worried about being gored by a rhino? Are you worried about being eaten by a lion or hippopotamuses? Or nobody asked him, are you worried about civil unrest? What did his company ask him? Are you going to be connected? Can we get in touch with you? And he says, no, I'm going to be in a tent on the savannah in Tanzania. So you won't have signal. No, you can't call me. So do you got the ability to text? No, I'm going to be in a tent on the savannah in Tanzania. Oh, okay. Have you thought about a sat phone? No. And they were all panicking. What do we do if something happens? And he said, you'll figure it out. And a month later when he came back, guess what? The building was still there. Everyone was still employed. They were still making money because he refused to let them determine how much time, you know, away he could have. I told this story, and a man comes up to me. He says, come here, come here, come here. I get all my best stories from other people. He says, come here, come here, come here. He says, my wife and I, we were just on vacation in Hawaii, and we were on this remote road, and we saw this little trail going down to the beach. So we stopped the car, and we got on this trail, and we walked down through a creek bed, and we walked back up the creek bed, and we walked through about 3/4 of a mile, and there's this open beach. And we're looking at it, and we're going, this is all to ourselves. And we start looking a little more closely, and way down the beach, there's a person, and way down the beach the other way, there's a couple other people, and they're thinking, oh, this is nice, and so they're holding hands, walking down the beach, just like our own private beach, isn't this wonderful, and they're walking, and the other couple is coming towards them, and they're walking, and they're realizing, oh, we're different than the other people on this beach. We're wearing clothes. And they looked at each other, and they said, well, this isn't really our thing, so let's go back. So they start walking back, and while they're walking back, someone has come out on the beach. And there's a naked man on a Hawaiian beach with his laptop. Schedule time away from information. You don't need this much information. You need time alone to quiet your brain. Most of us spend so much time busy, busy, busy that we never quiet our brain. The next thing to reduce information is to delegate jobs. When I'm working with executives doing my executive coaching work, I tell them, in an ideal world, this sentence should apply to your work, which is, only do what only you can do. Only do what only you can do. That's in an ideal world. Sometimes you got to pitch in. But you can delegate jobs. Now, if you were a good student, I'm talking to you. If you were a bad student, you know what I'm talking about. The difference between moderately successful, really smart people and wildly successful people of any level of smartness is their ability to delegate. Now, you remember when you were in high school, you had to do those stupid group projects, and there you are doing your group project, and they've assigned you Stoney. You know who I'm talking about. He was in wood shop all day, and he's in your group, and you're all going to get a group grade, and you're thinking, oh man, Stoney is not going to help us. So you look at Stoney, he's like, hey dude, man, what you want me to do for this project? And you look at Stoney and you go, Stoney, you're in charge of snacks. Awesome, I'm good with Doritos good. Doritos are great. What kind do you want? Stoney, you can check that one out yourself. So you work on your part of the project and Stoney's part of the project. You put it all together. And the night before, you call Stoney up and you go, hey Stoney, remember tomorrow? Yeah? Snacks. Oh yeah, 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 okay, I'll take a run down to 7-Eleven. I'll get Doritos, that's cool. So the next morning you get there, you've done your work, you've done Stoney's work, okay? Stoney comes in and the Doritos are all half eaten, but he brought them. You do the presentation, you get a good grade, Stoney gets a good grade, and you're bitter. And you've gone on, you've gotten advanced degrees, you've gone on and studied, you've worked really hard, and you go back to your 25-year class reunion, and you're thinking, I'm pretty successful. I'm pretty good, because you've done all the work, you've done all the heavy lifting, and there's Stoney 25 years later. And Stoney owns 18 lumber yards in 6 states. And you go, how did that happen? And how it happened is Stoney learned to delegate in high school, and he delegated to you. He knew he could get someone else to do it better. The reason he's so successful is he's figured out how to delegate and you haven't. Your success is capped by your unwillingness to delegate. And here's why. Because you're going to tell yourself, I can do it better than anyone else. You probably can. But if you're not doing it, you can do only what you can do. Let anyone else who can do it, even if it's not as well as you, let them do it so that you're doing the things that only you can do. Henry Ford said, I would rather have 99 men give me 1% of their effort than me to give 99% of my effort. And it worked out okay for him. So figure out how to delegate jobs. That is a key to success in life and in business. So how do you reduce information overload? You continue to simplify your life outside of work so that you're at peak mental performance at work. How do you do that? You do less things. Now, the enemy of the best is never the bad. The enemy of the best is the good. And in order to do what's best, in order to be at peak performance, to have an exceptional life, you are going to have to start saying no to good things. I don't need to tell anyone in this room, stop selling meth. Okay, I hope I don't have to say that. I don't have to tell you to stop doing bad things, but I do need for you to be having an exceptional life, to be more successful in every area of your life, to say no to good things. That means you're going to have to say no to your son's little league coach who wants you to be the assistant coach. You're going to have to say no to the Christian Missionary Aid Society who wants you to spend Saturday morning rolling bandages for people in Rwanda. You're going to have to say no to the PTA. You're going to have to say no to lots of things. And what happens when you say no to good things? One thing happens in you, you feel guilt. And what happens in other people? They get angry with you because they want you to do what they want you to do. Okay? Now, it's important. You're in the helping profession. I'm not going to, you know, people like me, we go, well, it's a good kind of selfish. There is no good kind of selfish. But what I'm talking about is self-interested. You've got to conserve the resources you have for long-term productivity. How many of you guys know the phrase, don't eat your seed corn? Not very many agricultural people. So what would happen before genetically hybridized seeds is the farmer would grow his crops, he would sell some to the grain mill, he would keep some back for his animals, he would keep some back for his own family's food, and then he would keep some for seed. And somewhere around February, the animals had eaten through all their stuff, his family had eaten through all of their corn, and they were hungry. And there in the barn are sacks and sacks of corn. What's the temptation? Eat that corn. That's their seed corn. Why don't you eat the seed corn? Because then you've got no crop, no productivity for the future. And ladies and gentlemen, you are givers. You are self-sacrificing. You've dedicated your life to the improvement of other people. You are far more likely to give and give and give and not set limits and say no to good things. And in order for you to serve your patients and serve your employees and serve your families and communities, you have to start saying no to good things, to conserve this resource. The thing that makes you good at what you do is not your hands, though you need your hands. The thing that makes you good is how you think. And if you're not conserving the resource of your brain and your ability to think, then you're doing a disservice long term. You need to do less. You'll feel guilty unless you construct it in your head that I'm doing this so that I can serve others for a longer period of time, so I don't burn myself out too soon. The second thing you need to do, besides doing less, and I really do mean doing less, having fewer commitments, is use less information. I was driving home from work in 1994 and listening to National Public Radio. And on National Public Radio in 1994 was a story about machete killings in Rwanda. And I'm listening to people scream while they're being hacked to death. And I'm thinking to myself, why am I listening to this? And I turned it off. And I have not intentionally watched the local news since 1994. I stopped taking the paper. I canceled lots of my magazine subscriptions. And unless I'm in a hotel, I don't ever watch the news. And people ask me, how do you get your news? Well, I spend about 8 minutes a day getting the headlines. And then people ask me in conversation, hey, did you hear about? And I say, no. And you know what they say? Well, let me tell you. So I have a conversation with people who've been, guess what I'm doing? I'm delegating my news gathering. I've saved an hour a day for the last 20 years to fill that time with more productive things. I use a lot less information. And I love information, but I let other people gather it for me. So I spend about 8 to 10 minutes a day reading headlines. And then everyone else fills in the gaps for me. You're all my information gatherers. Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. So use less information. Cancel your magazine subscriptions. Cancel your newspaper subscriptions. How many of you really need 587 channels on your TV? You only watch 8 of them. Okay, if that much. And so we have so much information coming in, we don't know how to consume it. And the last thing is set aside time for rest. The last thing for how to reduce information, set aside time for rest. Rest and recreation are two different things. Recreation is Disney. How many of you guys have been to Disney? Yeah. You feel rested at the end? No, that's not rest. That's recreation. And recreation is good. But recreation is not rest. Rest is doing nothing. It's sitting on the beach watching the waves come in, doing nothing. It's sitting in the woods and listening to the crickets chirp, doing Nothing. It's sitting in your backyard watching the neighbor's kids play. Why is it the neighbor's kids? Because you don't have to manage them. They can, you know, tear each other's hair out. You don't care. It's doing nothing. And a lot of you are saying to yourself, I don't know how to do nothing. I've got to always be going. I got to be doing stuff. Then start small. Start small with 5 seconds. Anybody practice yoga in here? Okay, there's a pose in yoga called Shavasana. It's how you end. And I'm really good at Shavasana, which is you lay on your back and you close your eyes. So awesome at that pose. And you do nothing. And if you're like me, I've got like this monkey mind. And it's like, hey, look at that. Whoa, whoa, squirrel. You know, I get that. I mean, that's, I get that. I understand that. But when I do nothing, it means that in yoga, they teach you to count your breathing. You close your eyes, and you, if your brain is going all over the place, start counting your breathing. So count for 5 seconds. Count 5 breaths. And at the end of that, you can go, woohoo, I'm a rock star. And then tomorrow, guess what I want you to do? I want you to amp that up to 6 seconds. I mean, you can maybe go to 10 seconds if you can. But if you're not good at doing nothing, then spend time doing nothing in quiet reflection. You know, there's a lot of talk now about mindfulness. Have you guys heard about mindfulness? It's a very old concept. We talk about Buddhist meditation, Hindu meditation, but in other religious traditions, there's also quiet contemplation. Or if, you know, you're from Oklahoma, pondering. We spend our time in quiet reflection, doing nothing, and you will have your best, most creative ideas, and you will quiet your brain down and allow it to recharge so you can make better decisions. You need rest, and you need sleep. We are an underslept society. One of the biggest health crises in America, obesity, is partially due to our lack of sleep. When you were young men and women in your 20s, you could get by on 4 hours of sleep, muscle through, and make it. If we take away electricity and clocks and people don't know what time it is, how long do they typically sleep for? They sleep on average about 8 hours. Our bodies need about a third of our day to recharge and recover. And we need dream sleep. A little aside here. We need dream sleep. Rapid eye movement sleep tends to be the thing that clears out all of the day's memories and the day's activities so that we're able to think clearly the next day. If we give people 8 hours of sleep but no REM sleep, rapid eye movement sleep, they tend to wake up not refreshed and they have difficulty. And that when we give them the opportunity to have REM sleep again, they overconsume REM sleep. The current theory now is that REM sleep is the thing that clears out the brain and works on learning and growth. It transfers things from temporary storage to permanent storage. So you need to rest. You need good sleep. What do you do in your own head? There's a number of cognitive strategies that you can use. The first is optimism. There's a great series of books written by a guy named Martin Seligman, who is the father of positive psychology. And he says that if you want to improve the quality of your life, improve the ability for you to think well, to be happy, to live exceptionally, and to be able to concentrate, you need to be optimistic. Unfortunately, popular press and popular psychology has turned this into wishful thinking. What Seligman is talking about is believing the truth, but believing the truth in certain ways. And he says that there are particular ways that pessimists think differently than optimists. By the way, how many of you in here will confess to being a pessimist? Okay, about 3 of you. Let me rephrase that. How many of you in here are not pessimists because you hate that term, but you're really realists? Oh yeah, the hands go up. The hands go up. Okay, so I'm going to tell you the secret. What's the difference between a pessimist and a realist? You ready? Drum roll. Brrr, nothing. What we know is that pessimists are more realistic than optimists. If you ask a pessimist to estimate the likelihood of an event occurring or the likelihood of success or failure of an event, the pessimist is usually right. The optimist, not so much. They're not wildly wrong, they're just not right as much. Comma, however, optimists live longer. They're happier. They have greater life satisfaction. They have more friends. They recover from illness faster than pessimists. So the choice is yours. Do you want to be right a little bit more often? Or do you want to live a longer, healthier, happier life with more friends? Totally up to you. It's your call. Optimists and pessimists think differently. If we can show this chart, you'll see on the chart, you'll see optimists and pessimists think differently. When a negative event occurs, a pessimist thinks it's permanent. They think it's pervasive or they take it personally. It's personalization. So let's use an example. Let's say I'm out with my friends and we're out dancing. And in the middle of the evening, my friends say, Roger, sit down. Get off the dance floor. You're embarrassing us. You're embarrassing yourself. Sit down. If I'm a pessimist, I'll take a permanent attribution to that problem. I'll be sitting there and I'll say, I suck at dancing. I took Fred Astaire, Arthur Murray. I even bought those DVDs where you cut out the stuff and put it on the floor. I can't dance. I come from a long line of bad dancers. I have a genetic dance malformation. I'll never dance again. That's a permanent attribution. Now, a lot of you who are pessimists do this in other areas of your life. I'm no good at X, fill in the blank. Therefore, I'm not even going to try. That's a permanent attribution. The second is pervasiveness. Pervasiveness doesn't take it to permanence in time only. It takes it to permanence in time and expands it to fill the universe of everything. So as I'm sitting there by myself while my friends are having fun dancing and I'm saying I suck at dancing, I extend it to I can't sing, I can't play a musical instrument, I'm not very much fun at parties, look at me, I'm sitting here by myself, kids in the neighborhood pointed and laughed, dog bit me, I'm a loser, ow, I hurt myself, I'm unworthy of love, deserving of punishment, I ought to live in a van down by the river. Thank you for liking that joke. We expand a specific instance to the totality of the world. I'm not good at this, therefore I'll never be good at anything. You may not do it, but you know people who do. And they talk like this, oh, nothing ever goes my way. I'm not good at anything. You hear that automatic talk. And that kind of thinking makes people less effective. And the last is personalization. Personalization is that black Eeyore cloud that follows you around. You remember Eeyore? Had his own special rain cloud. Bad things happened to him. Personalization. How many of you guys, when you're in the grocery store, you do line racing? You get in the shortest line, and you're like, oh, yeah, you're going down. I'm good at this, right? And you got your cart, and the conveyor belt moves a little bit. You put the little separator in, and you start unloading, and you're like, oh, yeah, I'm going to make time. I'm going to win. Woo-hoo, I'm getting out of here. And then the person in front of you reaches in their pocket, and they pull out this giant ball of crumpled up coupons, and you're like, oh. And they have to, like, you know, they have to rub them against, like, a surface to, you know, get them clear, and they scan them. Bink, bink, dunk. Oh, that one's expired. Oh, well, then I don't want it.
We need a manager on register 3 for a return.
And you're like, oh! And like, you think, okay, they're almost done. Okay, we're gonna get through. And then they bring out the checkbook. I like to write a personal check. And you're like, oh! We can run that right through the machine. That's okay, I'll write it myself. And then the tongue comes out and you know you're in trouble. You know this experience, and then here comes the phrase. You say, why does this always happen to me? When you say, why does this always happen to me, that's personalization. Pessimists think these three ways: permanence, pervasiveness, personalization. One or all of them. And that pessimistic pattern of thinking will keep you from being effective, keep you from making good decisions. Now, optimists, they don't believe in fanciful thinking, but they take a very different view on those events. So let's say I'm an optimist, and I'm out dancing with my friends, and my friends say, Roger, You're embarrassing yourself. You're embarrassing us. Go sit down. When I sit down, I go, well, yeah, I don't have my game on tonight, but wait till next week, baby. I got it. That, by the way, would be a lie. But it's a situation-specific attribution. I'm normally a good dancer. That's not true. But tonight, I don't have my game on. To combat pervasiveness, when my friends tell me to sit down, you're a bad dancer, I go, yeah, well, I'm not really much of a dancer. I can't sing, I can't play a musical instrument, all that's true, but I have other redeeming qualities. I recognize specific limitations, but those specific limitations don't extend to the whole universe. And then the last one, personalization. When I'm going through the line, what do I say when I lose? It's like, well, today wasn't my day, but next week, baby, I'm going to take it. It's not my fault, okay? I did my best. I did my level best to make this work. And I then can effect a change. Optimists don't believe in wishful thinking. They believe in the truth, but they look at it as situation-specific, event-specific, and not specific to them. That bad things happen to everybody and they can handle it. Good decision makers think this way. It frees up your brain for so many other opportunities. I'm going to teach you a system now to train your brain based on Albert Ellis's work. Anybody here familiar with who Albert Ellis is? About two of you. Go on YouTube, watch Albert Ellis. Make sure there are no kids around because he cusses like a sailor. But he was a genius. I had the chance to meet him a couple times when he was alive. But he came up with an ABC model of disciplined thinking. And what he says is that A stands for the adversity or the activating event. And in our world, we use language that says the activating event causes the consequence. That A, the activating event, causes the consequence. Let's use an easy example. My grandmother dies. And what do we say in our language? My grandmother died and that made me sad, right? So we connect the activating event with the emotional consequence. My grandmother died. That made me sad. Ladies and gentlemen, that is a lie from the pit of hell. You're thinking, man, that's harsh. I did love my grandmother. But here's the important variable that needs to change. The adversity creates a belief, a pattern of thinking that creates the emotional consequence. My grandmother dies, and I believe, oh, I'll never get that apple walnut waffle recipe. Oh, I won't be able to talk to grandma on Saturday morning and find out about grandpa. Oh, this Christmas, I won't be getting socks from grandma. I'm going to miss that. I'm going to miss a lot about grandma. I wish I would have told her I loved her more. Those are things that I'm thinking. The consequence of those thoughts is that I'm sad. The event creates a pattern of thinking. And if you have undisciplined thinking, you jump right to the emotion. So event creates thought, creates emotion. Activating event, belief, consequence. My grandmother's death doesn't make me sad. How I think about my grandmother's death makes me sad. Watch what happens when we change the belief. Grandma died. Belief, oh good, the old bird's dead. Now I get the money. Consequence, I'm happy. Do you see how easy it is? If we change our, not like that. We don't want to change it like that. If we want to change our beliefs, we have to do something about it. And unfortunately, we very often do the wrong things about it. The first thing we do is denial. When we have an unpleasant belief, we will go to a primitive state where we'll push a button in our head and turn, I'm just not going to think about it. This is pretend and forget. This is not Freudian denial. This is Scarlett O'Hara denial. What did she say? I think about it tomorrow. Okay, she's not going to think about it now. I'm just going to put it off. I'll put it out of my mind. I don't know how to do this. But what I know, and ladies and gentlemen, this should matter to you, is that people who use denial as a common strategy for dealing with their problems, their prefrontal is turned off, but their amygdala that activates the emotional engine, that's running all the time. The amygdala the periaqueductal gray, all of those areas then send signals to the pituitary, to the thyroid, to the adrenals. And what you get are people who have health problems, chronic health problems from the overactivation of the sympathetic nervous system, even though they're not consciously thinking about it. People are getting sick because they refuse to address the emotional and thought problems in their life. I don't know how to do denial, but ladies and gentlemen, I'm great at this next thing. So, what's the consequence of denial? Grandma dies, I think I'll miss her, I feel bad. Denial is, she's not really dead. She's just sleeping. I don't know why somebody would say that. Now, how well is that going to work? Denial is a poor short-term, poor long-term strategy for a disciplined thinker. The thing that I do, and you all do, is much like denial, and that's distraction. We have our society. We just talked about information overload and the effect it has on your decision making. We gather so much information that it distracts us all the time. If grandma dies and I don't want to think about it, I decide, you know what, I'm going to go to the movies. And for 2 hours, I'm not going to think about grandma dying. I distract myself with another engaging activity to handle those thoughts temporarily to quell those negative emotions. Distraction is a great short-term strategy. It is a lousy long-term strategy. If someone is unhappy, taking them to the movies is fine for 2 hours, but it'll never solve the underlying problem. If you have a problem at work or if you have a problem at home, getting some relief, having some fun, going to Disney, all of which is a distraction. Filling yourself with your work, becoming a workaholic, throwing yourself into your kids' baseball or soccer team. All of those are useful distractions, but they're only good short term. Long term, what happens? The limbic system, the periaqueductal gray fires. It makes the pituitary talk to the thyroid, which talks to the adrenals, boom, and you have the sympathetic nervous system overcharged and people get sick. When 9/11 happened, we have evidence that people used distraction to cope with the fear of that time. Do you know what our evidence is? 9 months later, there was a baby boom. Sex is a great distraction short term. However, if you're having sex with the wrong people in the wrong ways at the wrong times for a year, that's not such a good idea. So it's great short term distraction, but it's not a good solution. Alcohol, drugs, television, entertainment, all of those things are okay short-term distractions. If you have a bad day at work, you want to have a glass of wine, no problem. But if you have to have a 12-pack every night in order to deal with the stress of your life, you might be having a problem. You may not be a redneck, but you may have a problem. So distraction is great short-term. It's great short-term strategy, lousy long-term strategy. The next is deception. Ladies and gentlemen, the human species is an inherently self-deceptive species. When I'm talking about deception, I'm not talking about me lying to you. I'm talking about me lying to myself. Now, ladies, you know we men lie to ourselves all the time. It usually happens at Best Buy, where we say, babe, I've been thinking about the rainforest. And that 50-inch plasma screen TV that we have down in the rec room, it is an energy hog. I feel like every time I turn on the remote, I am cutting down a tree in the rainforest. But as I look at this 70-inch LED LCD screen, and I look at the energy savings we're going to have, I feel like this is the only responsible thing we can do for our planet. Now, you ladies are going, oh, yeah, you men, you're just like that. You are self-deceptive just like that. Ladies, I have one word, and you know what it is. Shoes. Okay? We men, we have 4 pairs of shoes. We have black shoes, we have brown shoes, we have tennis shoes, and depending on our lifestyle, we have boots. That's enough. We got it, okay? Ladies, you have 4 pairs of red shoes. We men are like, how can you have 4 pairs of red? And you say, well, they're different shades of red. Remember, ladies, we got the 8 box of crayons. There are no shades of red. And then you talk about heel height, right? Well, it's a different heel height. And men, I guarantee none of you except for Prince have ever bought pants longer than your legs. But every woman in this room has at least one pair of pants longer than her legs. Okay, so we all lie to ourselves. And so here's what happens. When I lie to myself about my grandmother dying, I tell myself what? I never really loved her. She smelled funny. Now, how good of a solution is that? That's a lousy solution. Lying to yourself is a bad short-term, bad long-term solution because people who lie to themselves tend to double down on their bad decisions. In an audience this size, I'm about to insult at least one of you. The people who do this are people who buy MGs and Triumphs. You know what I'm talking about? Those 1970s English sports cars, they're hunks of junk. They're buckets of bolts. And people buy those and they lie to themselves, oh, this is so much fun on a Saturday afternoon driving with the top down. Yeah, it takes a little 10 or 11 care. Yeah, you usually have to rebuild the engine after you drive it for 15 minutes. But I've always considered myself kind of a grease monkey. I don't like anything better than working on a car. It's just kind of therapeutic to me. Yeah, part of the adventure is when you go out for a drive in an MG, you just never know if you're going to get back. So much fun. And yeah, they got a little quirks. You know, they've got electrical problems that sometimes couple with the oil leaks that creates fires that come out through the vents in the dash. But, you know, part of the excitement of the car. So people buy these cars, then they join the MG car club, right? And then they sit around with other people who lie to themselves about how wonderful this vehicle is. And so you become the president of the MG Car Club, and your car burns to the ground on one drive. What do you feel compelled to do? Buy another, okay? And so what happens is when people lie to themselves about their quality of their decision making, they just double down on their bad decisions. I had a guy come up to me afterwards. He goes, you're talking about me. And I go, okay, what are you, what? And he goes, the MGs. I go, oh, I'm really sorry. He goes, I'm the president of the local MG car club. And I said, oh, I'm really sorry. And he says, I have 30. I said, you're beyond my capacity. He says, it's a disease. But you see it in your clients. They make bad health decisions. You know, they wash down their Cheetos, you know, with a big gulp and, you know, a healthy splash of Jack Daniels. And they think, well, that'll make me feel better. They double down on their bad decisions. So your job is to tell yourself the truth as best as you can. The next is disputation. This is the only positive short-term, positive long-term strategy. It's telling yourself the truth based on evidence. It's telling yourself the truth based on evidence. So when my grandmother dies, I tell myself, I am sad now, but as I look around at the evidence of other people who've lost loved ones, I know that I'm going to miss her for a while, and I'm probably miss her forever. But at the end, you know what's going to happen? I'm going to be able to live a happy life. It'll be bittersweet, but it'll be a good life. I can have a good life, because as I look around and I see other people, they have good lives. So ladies and gentlemen, if you want to be an excellent decision maker, you must be able to manage your thinking. Stop thoughts that are destructive, pessimistic, personalization, permanence, pervasiveness. Stop inaccurate lies that you tell yourself and tell yourself the truth based on evidence. Then you will be a better decision maker and be able to serve your clients better. Let me end with this. Do you know who this is? It's not Jimmy Buffett, it's Warren Buffett. Warren Buffett is the only man to make the Forbes 5 list, one of the 5 richest men in the world, without ever manufacturing a product or inheriting money. He made this money from having a long-term perspective. He looks at an investment, not what he's going to make today or tomorrow, but what he's going to make for 20 years. That's his event horizon. People who are successful have a long-term perspective. They're able to say no to the now in order to say yes to the long-term reward. Excellent thinkers, excellent decision makers all have a long-term perspective. Your clients, the problems that they have are sometimes a result of accidents that happen to them or from their own bad decisions. And you tell them, Your success will come in the long term, but it'll be a lot of work in the middle. And you know, some people just don't want to work that hard in the middle. You can teach them how to delay that gratification for the bigger, longer term reward later. Ladies and gentlemen, you do a great thing for your clients and your patients. You improve the quality of their lives, but they need you to protect your brain, your mind, your thinking, so that you can make great decisions to serve them for the long haul. Thank you very much. God bless.